Good afternoon. I'm Rossella Roversi, adjunct professor and research fellow within Bologna University Department of Architecture. On behalf of the ROC team, I welcome all the participants to this session led by Fondazione Fitzcarraldo about guidelines and tools for heritage-led regeneration initiatives. It is my pleasure to introduce the speaker of this session, Emanuela Gasca.
Thank you, Rossella, and good afternoon.
Welcome, Emanuela. Thank you for your participation. Before leaving the floor to Emanuela, I invite the audience to contribute to the discussion, writing any questions in the chat or in the Q&A. I'll be glad to read your questions for Emanuela at the end of her presentation. Just words about our speaker. Emanuela Gasca is a restoration architect, specialized on cultural heritage development and PhD on economic valuations and real estate appraisal at Politecnico di Torino. From 2007 to 2015, she had been a researcher at the Politecnico di Torino, working on national and international projects, dealing with territorial development, tourism management, and cultural policies. From 2016, she has been working for Fondazione Fitzcarraldo, where she is coordinator of transnational project. In fact, she is co-coordinator of the ROC project for Fitzcarraldo together with Damiano Aliprandi. Emanuela, would you like to add something about Fondazione Fitzcarraldo, its activities and its role in the ROC project?
Yeah, thank you, Rossella. Yeah, as Rossella said before, I work on this project with my colleague Damiano Aliprandi. We have the opportunity to have a challenge role. We have been invited from the University of Bologna to be the WUPI leader of one of the ROC World Package. In particular, our work has been like a bridge between the research part of the project and the most operative one, together with the territorial operators. As I will explicit in the presentation, we work with them, and in particular with cities, to identify the more significant aspects to face in an urban-led regeneration project. This approach has been very useful for us to build a toolkit that is the final output of the process. We developed this analysis also with the University of York, and in particular with Corrado Topi, that developed the topic of financial schemes. In this activity, we worked also in strict collaboration with the municipality and the University of Bologna, Fondazione Innovazione Urbana, Confindustria, and Eurocities.
Okay, thank you, Emanuela, for this sort of introduction. And I leave you the floor again for your presentation.
Thank you very much, Rossella. I'm going to open it. Okay. So good morning to everybody. We are going a little bit more in the presentation of today. What about the content that we will face today? The objectives of the Fondazione Fitzcarraldo contribution in the ROC project, the four levels of research, the results, and in the end, the toolkit and the canvas we developed in the project. Which were the objectives of the activity and the research question of our activity? We analyze the ROC ecosystem to identify evidences and recurring initiatives in the cultural heritage-led regeneration process in terms of main objectives, stakeholder, relating business models, and so on. Another objective focuses on the relationship with the organization involving cultural heritage-led regeneration projects, analyzing their external and internal dynamics, looking in particular to their business models in these urban processes, and then provide a set of methodological tools and canvas to elaborate business model useful for key players and policy makers involved in cultural heritage-led regeneration process. The research questions are about what are the most important dimensions for cultural heritage-led regeneration process, and in particular, how could we classify regeneration processes on cultural heritage, and what are best practices in rock cities. We do these steps, taking into account the rock cycle, that is the research framework of the project. We develop this activity taking into account the four main topics of the ROC project: knowledge sharing, heritage-led regeneration, city promotion, and sustainable economic development. We took into account these four dimensions in the research activity, but also in the development of the toolkit that was the deliverable, the final output of our activity. How we build the toolkit. At the first steps of the activity, we conduct three different research levels. The first is related with a literature review on secondary sources. What would be considered lead regeneration processes and what are the main dimensions. After that, an analysis of data that Eurocities collected from all the cities together with Urba Sofia, and then an analysis of best practices. Are there some best practices in the world that could inspire ourselves in the project? The core activity we developed was a survey that was carried out among the 10 cities involved in the project, and in particular we received something like four case studies, four best practices for each cities. In fact, we structured them as a survey addressed to all cities that try to investigate four main dimensions. In the first step, what is the identity and the main value of these cultural heritage-led regeneration processes? What are the strategic and the specific objectives related to them? Then, if cities applied or not a business model, and what were the relationship between different stakeholders. After that, the offer and the case study. We indagate if there were some specific case studies that the city considered as the best practices, with a specific reference to the relationship with the targets, and in particular with territorial communities. Sorry, I think, I don't know if there are some problems with the presentation, but we could solve it briefly. Okay, about the results. After his research, some reflection came to us. The first, linked with the reason behind the choice to intervene on specific buildings or sites in the historical center, its leading purpose and aims. After that, different typologies of cultural-led regeneration processes in rock cities. In some times, somewhere, initiatives are concentrating on specific projects like a building, a bridge, and so on. In some other case, they could be considered as strategic processes that involve a strategic plan for the cities in a big period of time. Surely, the topic of the target involved, if the project has been addressed to specific targets or to all the territorial or cultural community, and then the relationship between regenerated buildings or sites and local stakeholders, with particular attention to the local communities living or working in the historical city center. We study also the results relating with the players. In fact, doing this survey, we saw that there are different typology of players involved in these processes, institutions, mainly public ones, or profit organizations, such as companies, enterprises, industries, etc., or non-profit organizations, running activities on particular social or cultural interests located in the historical building. And this was a very important information for us because convinced us to build two typologies of canvas, one for public institutions and another one for private institutions and organizations. What about the final output, the final deliverable of our activity? The final deliverable was a toolkit that is a report that you could download from the ROC website. And this toolkit is based on the ROC central idea that the main challenge of any intervention on abandoned historical cities is not only the physical restoration or maintenance of large structures, but also to turn them into a driver of territorial process of regeneration. The toolkit objectives are, I think, on two different levels. The first one is to define a replicable methodology for the design of business models useful to place based strategies in cultural-led regeneration processes, fostering economic growth and social inclusion. And on the other side, to provide guidelines and canvas for different actors involved in cultural-led regeneration initiatives. To develop this toolkit, we develop also two different canvas. The first was the canvas for public bodies that is articulated as the figure on the slide shows. This canvas has three main areas, three main building blocks. Two of them, the one on the left and the one on the right, are dedicated on the one end to direct users and on the other end, on audiences. This toolkit, the aim of this canvas is to propose a methodology, to propose an approach. On the one end, it's very important to know who are the person involved, who are the project manager of this project, but on the other end, it's very important to take in account also the audience, the community, where this project is located. In the building block, in the middle, there are costs and resources that could be considered not only economic resources, but also, for example, human resources, territorial resources, environmental resources, and so on. And this building block in the middle part of the canvas is relating with the two main important areas of this canvas, the purpose and aims, and the expected results and impact. The purpose and aim related to the values that this cultural heritage and regeneration processes would like to communicate, also in not only in a brief period but also in a strategic way, and then about expected results and impact, because as you know, when we are conducting cultural or restoration projects, it's very important to take into account the impact that it will have in the territorial area, not only when the project finishes, but during all the development, all the duration of the project. After that, we decide to create also a canvas for private organizations. We try to use our data collecting from cities, from rock cities, to identify what could be the main important actors of a process like this, the main important private actors. Here we try to identify them in these diagrams, and the two variables are the cultural dimension and the importance of historical center. And, for example, on the one end, on the bottom left, general users that are, for example, companies with not interest, with not specific interest in cultural heritage, but motivated by other factors. And in, on the other side, for example, on the top right, the cultural enhancers that are probably cultural organization or cultural association that are directly involved in the process. And this is the canvas that we developed. I forgot to say at the beginning that in our research activity, we evaluate and we study different types of canvas to arrive to this one. That is like a proposal of a methodological approach starting for the value proposition. And what is the main value that is cultural heritage led regeneration process could enhance in the territorial area. Thank you for your attention. And if you have some questions or information, please don't hesitate to ask now or to contact me or Damiano Liprandi by mail. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Emanuela. With your presentation, we have been really led into an intermediate dimension between research and practice, as you said before. And as the audience had the opportunity to understand in these days of conference, this dimension is particularly relevant in the ROC methodology. For those of you that are interested in taking a closer look and deepen the knowledge of the governance toolkit developed by Fitzcarraldo, you can download the deliverable 3.2 available in the ROC website. I've pasted the link in the chat so you can reach the correct web page directly. I also invite you to do the same with the other documents, deliverables, and reports that you can find in the same page. Now let's check if we have questions from the audience. I remember, okay. Yes, we have a question by Julia. Julia asks, good afternoon, the toolkit you have just described has been developed in the framework of a Horizon 2020 project. What was the added value of working in a consortium made of so many and different type of partners? Yes, Julia's right. Yes, indeed, in the ROCO consortium, we have 32 partners from 13 different countries. Emanuela.
Yeah, thank you, Rossella, and thank you, Julia, for this question. I think that ROC project is a really good challenge opportunity to work with different types of subjects, from public institutions to private operators and so on. I think that these aspects give us the possibility to work on heritage-led regeneration processes with a European and interdisciplinary approach. As I said before, one of our first research activities has been focused on the analysis of the attitude that is 13 cities involving ROC are dealing with these kinds of process in terms of stakeholder involvement, main target, type of research. And I think that in this framework, having different European points of view, not only from cities, but from all the consortium, was a very big value. As I said before, also the research part at the beginning was a very, very participating process because we work a lot with the University Municipality of Bologna, Confindustria, Fondazione Innovazione Urbana, Eurocities, to find a way, a significant and a challenge way to go deeply to our goal research.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we have no other questions. So I ask you a question for myself. In ROC, you had to deal with 7 role model cities and 3 replicator cities. So not only a wide multiplicity of partners, but also a wide multiplicity of urban environments, cultural heritage, socioeconomic context. So what are the invariant aspects or, let's say, ingredients you need necessarily to take into account in a business model for such different cities? And what the main differences that you can't ignore?
Okay, this is a very complex question, but I will try to answer very, very briefly. I think that to answer to this question, we have to take into account probably two main dimensions dealing with the role of cities. The first element I would like, it would be important to identify, is related with the art and soft infrastructures in terms of on-the-ground projects and services related to them, and players, the main actors involving cultural heritage and regeneration process. In this framework, it would be important to recognize relationship between them in terms of projects and processes. Public institutions are, in fact, most of the time in charge of defining policies at the broadest level, therefore including specific areas for particular interests. At the same time, usually they are the owners of buildings or sites of cultural heritage interest located within historical city centers. And the enhancement, we could say, of cultural heritage usually exceeds from the financial and managerial capabilities of single municipalities, making the case for the involvement of private players. And in this framework, the partnership between public and private subjects are strategic in terms of bringing together public and private sector players, working together towards shared goals and objectives, contributing time, money, expertise, and other resources, sharing decision-making and management responsibilities, and so on. I don't know, Rossella, if I answered to your question.
Yes, completely. Yes, and we have two questions more in the conversation chat. I don't know if you can read them with me. One question is, good morning, can you talk me about the role of private actors in PPP model in Iraq? Thank you.
Yeah, we haven't, I could say, a specific focus on this topic. I think that we analyze these elements on the whole ROC framework, taking into account their role to make the canvas. I think that it's a very, that they have a very key role from the fact that the cities involved in ROC and the project they underline in this research are very, very different. But I could say in our research, we didn't have a specific focus on this topic, but it is an information that we collect in the overall framework of the research. If you have, Christina, some other doubts or some curiosity, you could download our deliverable. And if you have some more specific question, please write to us. We could share ideas and opinions.
Okay, so you have already answered also to the question of Christina.
Yeah.
Perfect. And well, if I can, I will make another question. As we haven't, let me check. Okay, we have one minute more. So just the time to another question, if you don't mind. Historical European cities I have been particularly afflicted by the effects of the pandemic. In the previous today's sessions, in particular, the one led by Patrizia Sproni and Stefano Cozzolino, we have already had the opportunity to deal with the significant and long-lasting repercussions of the pandemic on the cultural sector. I would like to have your opinion and in particular know if the governance tool that you have described developed in the absence of the sanitary emergence, I think, is still completely valid, or if you would suggest any changes or additions in the light of the present situation.
Yes, in reality, this tool has been developed before, in the absence of the sanitary emergency. This aspect will probably not have much impact on the structure of the toolkit, but rather on its context. In fact, the canvas itself suggests some interpretation of the phenomena, even though it is not the answer to the individual phenomena themselves and to individual emergencies. But I think it's important to say it suggests an approach that could be implemented also in the pandemic period, where communities engagement, I think, is very important to co-create new experience in physical or digital space to try to continue to live during this pandemic period.
Okay, thank you very much, Emanuela. The topic would deserve many insights, but we have unfortunately run out of time. Thanks to all the audience who listened to our session and participated with questions. With the end of the present session and the parallel one, we are also arrived at the end of this 4 days journey inside the ROC project. Now, actually in about 5 minutes, we are going to have the closing plenary that we warmly invite you to join. We will have the pleasure to host the Vice Mayor of the City of Bologna, Valentina Orioli, for a final reflection on the ROC methodology for co-designing culturally dynamic and sustainable neighborhoods. Don't miss the music performance that will follow in collaboration with the Teatro Comunale di Bologna that will bring the ROC Open Knowledge Week to a closure. Goodbye.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.